Hi, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever time it is you're watching this. And as always, happy whatever day it is you're watching this. Welcome to episode 37 of Left Side of the Aisle. This is for the week of December 29th through January 4th. I'm your host. My name is Larry Erickson. And for the next half hour or so, I'm going to be your ranter and raconteur. I'm going to be talking about things important to me that I think deserve to be important to you as well. As always, I'd like to say that if you have any comments, questions, reactions, whatever about the show, please do email me. You can email me directly. My email address is hoviating, that's hoviating at AOL.com. And if you missed that, my website, Lotus Surviving a Dark Time, will be, name will be up around here somewhere a couple times during the show. And you can just go there and get the email address from there. I do answer my email. I will make one request that if you do email me, in the subject line, please say something like your show or about your show or Left Side of the Aisle or LSOTA or something so that I don't think it's spam, of which, like everybody else, I get way too much. All right, a couple of things this week. The first I wanted to do a couple of updates on things I've talked about before. The first is about the National Defense Authorization Act. This is the bill that authorizes spending on things like the military, the wars, national defense, security things, and so on. And I talked about this bill because it had some very bad provisions in it. Well, that bill has been passed. It has been signed into law with the provisions still in it. What these provisions do, these provisions actually authorize the U.S. military to arrest and indefinitely detain without trial or charge anyone accused of being a member of Al-Qaeda or an associated group, which in practical terms could pretty much mean most anybody, any administration at any given moment happened to dislike. And they can do this even if the person's captured on American soil, even if it's an American citizen captured on American soil. And the reference to indefinitely detained, this is what it's always called, and I just find that such an incredibly neutral description, indefinitely detained. What it means is they can snatch you off a street, throw you in a prison, and never let you out. You can be legally disappeared. There's something called an oubliette, I believe that's the proper pronunciation. It comes from the French meaning to forget. And this was a kind of cell that you found in certain dungeons. It was a cell where the only access was through the ceiling. And basically, you got thrown into one of those cells, and they then just kind of forgot you were there. And whenever I hear this expression about indefinitely detained, I always think of an oubliette. Barack Obama had threatened to veto this bill because of some of these provisions, which really heartened civil liberties advocates. But we were distressed when we discovered the actual reason why he was threatening to veto the bills. It wasn't because of the threat to civil liberties and political freedoms that this presented. It wasn't because of the dangers of this sort of frontal attack on basic human rights. No, he was going to veto the bill because it restricted him too much. It put too many restrictions on him. You see, The bill required the military to deal with accused terrorists, and even at that it goes too far because the word accused implies some kind of more formal process that was actually would be going on here. It's more like alleged or assumed terrorists, because as we all know, when it comes to terrorists, assumption equals concrete proof. Anyway, shouldn't call them accused, but anyway, the bill says that the military is supposed to deal with these terrorists, these accused terrorists, but it didn't allow, the bill did not allow the president to decide whether it should be the military or civilian authorities that dealt with this particular person. That's why he was going to veto it. The bill was changed to say the president could be the one to make that decision, and zap, Barack Obama was right there with his presidential pen in hand. Now, the proponents of these provisions say that any concerns about them are just nonsense, or just silly, fear-mongering, because the bill says it doesn't change existing law. And it does say that. It says this bill does not change existing law. The problem is both the Bush and the Obama administrations have argued that these powers already are existing law, the power even to arrest and indefinitely detain American citizens taken on American soil, they say they already have the power to do this. They claim the powers first in their role as commander in chief. I never understood the logic of that, what this has to do with that. But they also say that Congress granted them the authority with the authorization to use military force, or the AUMF, it's known. This was a provision that was passed in the wake of 9/11 that gave the president the authority to use military action against al-Qaeda or its allies. But the thing is, in court cases, the argument against this power of indefinite detention has been that Congress never intended the president to have that kind of unrestricted authority. Well, by passing this bill with these provisions intact, Congress has, in essence, just told the courts that, yes, we do intend the president to have this kind of authority. This bill was opposed by the entire spectrum of human rights organizations, Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, the ACLU, everybody was against it. Now, Barack Obama says he will never use these powers. He just wants them. He'll never use them. Well, the thing, even if you're prepared to believe that, about an administration that has already set a record for prosecution of whistleblowers, an administration that is not only upheld, it has expanded Bush-era claims and arguments about executive powers. Even if you want to believe that about an administration that's been treating Bradley Manning the way it has, are you prepared to make that same guarantee about every future administration? This bill is an abomination. And I dearly, dearly, dearly hope that the courts will throw it out, because if not, we have a real problem. Speaking of Bradley Manning, that brings up the other thing I wanted to update. His pretrial hearing is over, and everybody expects it's now going to proceed to a full court-martial, like that was ever in doubt. There was no way that the government was not going to have this go to full court-martial. The thing is, in the course of this, in the course of these proceedings, let's not forget who the real target is, what the real issue is here. The reason Bradley Manning was held in conditions amounting to torture under international law, held in solitary confinement, held in prison for 18 months before he ever saw a judge. Why they're piling charge on charge on charge on him. The real target of this, Julian Assange. The real target is to get Julian Assange and, through destroying him, destroy WikiLeaks. The feds have been trying to find something, anything, any crime that they can pin on Assange. There has been a federal grand jury in Virginia over a year now working on this. Joe Biden and Newt the Grinch have both called Assange a terrorist. Sarah Palin says he should be hunted down. Other people say he should be assassinated. The treatment of Bradley Manning, all that's been done to Bradley Manning, there is every reason to believe that the actual purpose is to force him to testify, if necessary, falsely, to testify against Julian Assange so they can get WikiLeaks on something. And this is all because he, that is Assange, that is WikiLeaks, all because WikiLeaks released information that embarrassed us. And I need to specify that. I don't mean, not us. No, it wasn't. It embarrassed the Pentagon. It embarrassed the White House. It embarrassed the State Department. It didn't embarrass us as a people. Because the one thing our government, the one thing any government can't stand, is having ordinary citizens know what it's doing. And that's what's happened here. Remember that there was a video, you may have seen it, it's called Collateral Murder. If you haven't seen it, it's on YouTube, it's called Collateral Murder, it's had over 12 million views. This is a U.S. military video taken from a helicopter in Baghdad. And it shows the people in that helicopter shooting down a group of men milling around a street corner because the guys in the helicopter thought they saw a couple of weapons in the group. Weapons which, by the way, turned out to be cameras held by a Reuters photographer and his assistant. And later on, in that same video, that helicopter shoots up a passenger van with some children inside because the people in the van were trying to carry away the wounded. That video, Collateral Murder, was among the materials Bradley Manning is accused of leaking to WikiLeaks. The government did not want you to see that video. The government did not want you to know that. Now, the prosecution says there was irrefutable evidence that Bradley Manning defied the nation's trust. That's nonsense. The government is not the nation, even less is the military the nation. Bradley Manning may have defied, assuming he's guilty, he may have defied the military's trust, but he didn't defy the nation's trust. He did what any good citizen, and being a citizen is a higher rank than being a member of the military. He did what any good citizen would do. He saw evidence of government wrongdoing and took steps to make sure the people knew about it. Bradley Manning, assuming he's guilty, is a hero. All right. Enough for updates. Now I'm going to move on to something which, again, I hope to make a weekly occasion here if I can. The outrage of the week. The outrage of the week. In the weeks and months, and hopefully I'm going to have a little graphic up here, a little silly little graphic, which will get better in time, but for the moment. In the weeks and months leading up to the Iraq War, a number of TV networks had retired military brass on as analysts to explain military things to the rest of us. At the time, some folks remarked on how these brass always seemed to operate within the narrow confines of conventional wisdom, but the networks defended the use on the ground that these people were the experts. In 2008, the New York Times revealed how after 9/11, the Pentagon had sought to establish close relationships with these network military analysts with the intention of turning them into surrogates, into message force multipliers for the Bush administration's march to war. The article also revealed how some of these analysts who had ties to defense contractors were improperly using their access to the Pentagon through this program as leverage in obtaining contracts for their companies. Well, in January 2009, the Department of Defense's Office of the Inspector General issued a report on this, said they found absolutely nothing wrong with it, and then almost immediately retracted the report because they said it was so bad you couldn't trust anything in it. They started over, and now, just recently, just a few days ago, they released their final report. This report confirms that under Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld during the Bush administration, there was a concerted effort to use retired military network analysts as a means to increase and maintain public support for the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. For those military, there were meetings at the Pentagon. There were conference calls with top brass. There were supply talking points. There were Pentagon-sponsored trips. And your participation, your continued participation in this group, depended upon how closely you towed the Pentagon line. To the point where Wesley Clark, he was the former a supreme commander of NATO, which certainly seemed to make him an expert in military stuff. He was working as an analyst for CNN, and he criticized the Pentagon, as the result of which he got frozen out of the program, and a CNN official actually told him that the White House wanted him to be fired. Now, something I want to emphasize here, that last bit about Wes Clark, that came from his statement to the investigators. Everything before that about the program was what this report concluded. However, the investigators said they could not find any document that described the intent of the program. To determine intent, they relied entirely on interviews with Donald Rumsfeld's former public affairs officers, who said, much to our shock, "Manipulate public opinion? Us? Perish the thought." Oh, no, no, this program just was, in the words of the report, intended to serve as an open information exchange with credible third-party subject matter experts, and it complied with all Defense Department regulations. The Inspector General also looked at the issue of the analysts who were potentially improperly using their access in order to advance their business interest. How did they investigate this? They asked the analyst, "Did you use this to advance your business interest?" Wonder if wonders, they said no. At which time, the report concludes that the notion that this sort of insider access could be financially beneficial was simply a perception. So let's sum up. The Pentagon is accused of running a covert program to use network military analysts as message force multipliers to manipulate public opinion in support for an atrocious war. The program also involves some of those analysts improperly using their access to advance their own interest. The Pentagon investigates itself by asking the accused if they are guilty. And when the accused say no, they decide all is well. Put it more briefly, the Pentagon investigates itself and declares itself not guilty. That may not be a surprise, but it still is the outrage of the week. Okay, moving on from there. That moves rather easily into our next topic, the end of the Iraq War. Or I should say the pretend end of the Iraq War, the end for Americans, not for Iraqis. This is the war that was conceived in lies, conducted in lies, and concluded in lies. In the run-up to the war, there was an attempt to mobilize public opinion by multiple repetitions of a threat. What a threat Iraq was. It was called, these are all quotes, okay? Iraq was called the most dangerous threat of our time, an imminent threat. Yes, they did say imminent. Imminent threat, serious threat, terrible threat, serious and mounting threat, a real threat, a unique and urgent threat, a significant threat, a dangerous threat, a threat of unique urgency, a grave threat, an immediate threat, a mortal threat, a threat distinct from any other. We were told that Saddam Hussein had the design for a nuclear weapon, that he was actively enriching uranium and seeking more uranium from Africa. He was buying aluminum tubes, which we were assured could only be used for enriching uranium. And we were told he had an aggressive nuclear weapons program. And in fact, we could not allow the final proof, in the words of Condoleezza Rice, we can't let the final proof be a mushroom cloud. We're also told that he possesses nuclear and biological weapons. Oh yes, we were told not only does the government know he has them, they know how much and what sorts. And that he is constantly enhancing his capability and has proved in word and deed that he is striving to have the means to attack us here at home. It was all lies, all of it. It was all just wild claims to justify the war, to sell us on a war on which the White House had already decided. In fact, in January 2004, former Treasury Secretary Paul O'Neill said that Bush began planning to attack Iraq within days of becoming president in January 2001. Now, the White House called O'Neill everything short of a mentally unbalanced nutcase, but documents that were declassified in 2010 say he was right. And then there were the Downing Street memos. This is something that should have been had a bigger impact than it did. This was notes from a meeting among some of the top ministers of the Prime Minister Tony Blair of the United Kingdom, a meeting of some of his ministers. This is on July 23rd, 2002. This is 8 months before the invasion. One of the people in that meeting was Sir Richard Dearlove. He was the head of Britain's Foreign Intelligence Service. It's known as MI6. He had just come back from some meetings in Washington, and he told Blair that Bush had already decided to attack Iraq and had already decided how he was going to justify that attack: terrorism and weapons of mass destruction. In fact, he also said that I'm quoting here from the memo, the intelligence and facts were being fixed around the policy. That is, the policy has already been decided. Now we're going to go figure out a way to justify it. It was all lies. There was no nuclear weapons program. There were no weapons of mass destruction. It was all lies. Oh, but, you know, after months of looking, nothing could be found. Then we got told, everybody thought he had him. Don't blame us. Everybody thought he had him. No, not everyone. Some people knew better. Former Weapons Inspector Scott Ritter knew better. Democracy Now! Knew better. Former Iraqi nuclear scientist Ahmad Kaduri knew better. The weapons inspectors, the UN weapons inspectors, who were in Iraq from the end of November 2002 until the day before the bombing began in March 2003, they knew, as the Los Angeles Times said, the inspectors have yet to find a smoking gun, a trace of radiation, or a single germ spore. In fact, those inspectors called U.S. intelligence on weapons in Iraq garbage, which just led to wild goose chases. And I knew. In an op-ed I wrote, stated March 6, 2003, I said, I'm quoting here, "Before we go to war on Iraq, there's a question about its weapons of mass destruction that needs to be answered." What weapons of mass destruction? Seriously, what weapons, where? Months of effort, hundreds of inspections, and hundreds of sites have turned up zilch. And more importantly, the Bush administration knew. Back in September 2002, George Bush claimed that a report from the International Atomic Energy Association said that Iraq was only 6 months away from getting a nuclear weapon. There was no such report. He made it up. What's more, the administration played up statements supposedly made by General Hussein Kamel. He was the highest ranking Iraqi defector ever. And supposedly he was telling about all these aggressive plans and these aggressive weapons programs and so on. Well, in March 2003, before the war began, Newsweek got a hold of a transcript of the debriefing. And he didn't say any of that. He said, rather, quoting the article, "After the Gulf War, Iraq destroyed all its chemical, biological weapon stocks and the missiles to deliver them." It was all lies. And that's what I want to emphasize, because there's so much work that could be said on this, so much more that could be said. These were not mistakes. This was not bad intelligence. This was not everybody thought. These were lies. We were lied into war. The war started lies on top of lies, lies about that we were liberators, lies about Jessica Lynch. Remember Jessica Lynch? All the lies about Jessica Lynch in her story, lies about Abu Ghraib being just a few bad apples, lies about the death, the destruction, the casual brutalities, the indifferent slaughter, lies about cover-ups of war crimes. And what have we come out with? 4,500 U.S. dead, thousands more wounded. And how many Iraqis dead? Nobody actually knows. The most conservative estimates of just civilian deaths drawn from newspaper accounts say over 100,000 Iraqis died indirectly in violence. Household surveys using standard methodologies and counting everyone who died as a result of the war, including indirectly from things like lack of health care and so on, they say the estimates run between 600,000 and over a million Iraqis killed as the result of our invasion. And the lies go on. They go on even now. The biggest lie of all was told just recently by Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta. He said the war in Iraq was worth it. Worth it to who? The dead, the maimed, the refugee, the homeless? Worth it to the half of Iraqis who say they are worse off as a result of the U.S. invasion? Was it worth to the 63 people killed, the nearly 200 wounded in a car bomb and IED attacks just Monday morning? I'm sorry, last Thursday, that was. Worth it to the three more killed by bombs Thursday night? Worth it to the four killed and four wounded by bombs on Sunday night? Worth it to the seven killed and more than 30 wounded Monday morning? More to the two killed and the two wounded Monday afternoon? Is it worth it to the 10 people on average killed a day? That's over 3,600 a year. 10 people killed on average a day by bomb attacks in Iraq. Is it worth it to them? There is one person who might think it was worth it. Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki, who seems to be cementing his hold on power as the civilian government, the coalition government in Iraq splinters. And he attempts to have the vice president of Iraq arrested on terrorism charges. I wonder how long it'll be before the White House starts praising the stability Maliki can bring to Iraq. And I expect I'll have more to say about the domestic political crisis in Iraq next week. But I have one last thing that I want to talk about. I don't know if I want to talk because it's a little lighter or it's a little silly or because the underlying truth of it is, again, rather disturbing. Rebecca Haynes of Peabody, Massachusetts. She was flying home from Las Vegas just recently, and an airport security officer in Las Vegas confiscated her frosted cupcake because he said the icing on it was a security risk. Yeah, the Transportation Security Administration agent in Las Vegas told her her frosting on her cupcake was enough like a gel to violate TSA restrictions. Restrictions on allowing gels and liquids on flights because they might be explosives. Now, she said the agent didn't seem concerned that the cupcake actually was an explosive, just said it fit some bureaucratic definition of what was allowed. She told him that, you know, she had passed through security at Logan Airport with two cupcakes just a couple of days before, and he said that just proved the agents at Logan weren't doing their job. Now, I tell this story not only because it's idiotically bureaucratic, but also because of what Haynes said in response. And I'm quoting her here. "It's not really about the cupcake. I can get another cupcake," she said. "It's about an encroachment on civil liberties. We're just building up resistance and tolerance to all these things they're doing in the name of security when it's really theater. It's not keeping us safe." Right on, Rebecca Haynes. You nailed it. You nailed it. Because one of the big issues that I have raised consistently about this security theater, as it's called, is that it is intended to inure us, to get us used to the idea of being stopped, of being questioned, of being searched, of having to justify anything and everything we do to some government official. It's to get us used to the idea of being constantly on watch, constantly on our guard. And this is just another example of it. Another example of it. There's a poem that some of you, oh dear, I don't remember if it's Carl Sandburg or Robert Frost. It's one of those two. You should look it up. It's called Departmental. And it is about the bureaucratic mind, and you should check that up about what it is. I'm just about out of time. I got about 1 minute left. So I just wanted to spend that minute to say thank you for watching. I encourage any and all responses, any and all comments. Next week, too, I hope to. I haven't talked about Occupy for a while. I want to get back to that. And I wanted to wish again, as I did last week, you and your family the best of the holiday seasons, the best and most joyous new year, the most peaceful new year you can have. Like the song says, let's make it a good one. You have a great week, folks. I will see you next week with episode 38 of Left Side of the Aisle. And we'll talk to you soon. Bye.